Now, I'll go back to some of the points you mentioned, former Secretary Panelo's name. So let me read his quote just this morning for the benefit of our viewers. He responded to your press conference, I believe, yesterday, and he said, this is the quote, there is no gentleman's, there is no such gentleman's agreement. I talked with PRRD about this, and he said he never entered into any gentleman's agreement with China regarding Ayungin Shoal. Whoever claims that Canard only wants publicity. So two things here. He claims to have spoken with the former president, and former President Duterte is now denying that he got into such agreement. Your thoughts, attorney?
I will repeat it. That is correct. There is no specific agreement on Ayungin. The gentleman's agreement is to respect the status quo on the entire West Philippine Sea dispute. So that is correct. I do not deny that. And that is why I am, in fact, surprised that what has been coming out in the media is a sellout of sorts. Why? Did we lose any territory? Did we lose Sierra Madre? Did the president order the removal of Sierra Madre? Certainly not. So the agreement is on how to manage the entire dispute on the West Philippine Sea and not specifically on Ayungin. Now, having said that, no, we knew the Chinese communicated that what warranted that the water cannon incident was the delivery of supplies and construction materials. The administration before, the Aquino administration, also knew that the Chinese will object to delivery of construction materials as well as repair materials. And that is why in 2003, Secretary Gasmin publicly stated, and this is on the internet, it's on the Inquirer, 2003, no, that for as long as the supplies are limited to water and food, then China will not object. Now, after that water cannon incident in during Duterte's time, there was no further water cannon incident on Ayungin or on Sierra Madre. So again, which brings us to the point of what do you do in a predicament where we need to deliver food and water so that our soldiers can stay in BRP, or should we proceed in a manner that the Chinese will prevent us from even delivering?
So what do you believe should the Philippines be doing? Because you did issue a statement and you said that the Philippines may lose Ayungin Shoal, and I'm rephrasing this now, if the present administration continues its hard line stance. How so? How so can we lose Ayungin Shoal with this administration's foreign policy?
Well, if we continue to deliver construction and repair materials, okay, in a manner that causes attention of the Chinese, they will prevent any and all further deliveries of any supplies, including food and water. And that will, of course, force us to recall our soldiers because they will starve to death in Sierra Madre. That should be avoided at all costs because, as you know, in disputed territory, physical presence or occupation, no, is almost equivalent to title. Although, I hasten to add, there is no title here. It is an exclusive economic zone. Now,
attorney, is that the only recourse for the Philippines to actually back down? I mean, leave BRP Sierra Madre? Isn't there another recourse for us?
Well, I'm saying what the possible consequences are. It's not within my control what China or what China will not do. But judging from history, China will not allow further deliveries of construction or repair materials. And this has been made very clear to us since the time of President Aquino, no? Where Gasmin acknowledged that therefore there will be limited deliveries of food and water. But there's such a thing as discarte. I do not believe that we did not deliver construction or repair materials, but it can be done in a manner that would not provoke the Chinese in a manner that they are being provoked now. Discarte. And that's what is probably lacking now, no? And which leads me to my next point, no? Are we really wanting to provoke China to respond in a way that we know she will, because we want the United States to come to our rescue under the Mutual Defense Treaty? And what I'm saying is, it is foolhardy for us to think that they will in fact come to our rescue, because we lost Mischief Reef, they did not come to our rescue. We lost Scarborough Shoal, they did not come to our rescue. The MDT exists, but of course, whether or not the United States will get involved militarily will depend on their national interests. And because China is their biggest trading partner, China is their biggest creditor, I don't think our dispute with China over this derelict ship will warrant a military response from the United States.
So you're actually right now giving a more sober analysis on what the Philippines can end up with, right? Because you do have critics that are quite idealistic and they're holding on to the victory, the arbitral ruling. You have Senator Risa Ontiveros has issued a statement saying the president has always kowtowed to China. You have other critics saying that at the start of the Duterte administration, he actually gave up, in a way, our sovereign rights when it came to the West Philippine Sea with his statements. But what you're saying really is the fact that at the end of the day, who's going to come to help the Philippines? We're left alone. There has to be another.
Yeah. That is correct. But let me correct Senator Ontiveros. No? Mm-hmm. It was during the term of Duterte that the arbitral ruling came out. And contrary to her allegation, no? The president did address the UN General Assembly online because it was a time of COVID. And it was there that he announced to the whole world that the arbitral decision already forms part of public international law. No? Now, there's a reason why diplomacy is covered by an exception to freedom of information. And that is because diplomacy must be made pursuant to the best national interest and not pursuant to a popularity of one's decision. Now, what the president did, I believe, President Duterte, is to make sure that our presence in Sierra Madre will be undisturbed. Because if we were to leave Sierra Madre, it would have the same effect as when we left Scarborough, and also the same effect as when we left Mischief Reef.
Okay. But then, is this agreement in the interest of the country? Clearly, President Marcos Jr. has taken a more firm and vocal stand against China's provocations, and in fact has even formed the Maritime Council just recently. So we'll talk about two things. No? Let's talk about this administration's stand. You believe that this administration's stand, the stand of this administration, will move us into losing a Yungin-Shon. Is that what you're saying too?
It will lead to that. If it insists on a hard line, then the reality is we know how China will react. And you know, there's a quote, in fact, attributed to Einstein, no? That it's insanity to keep on doing the same thing over and over again and expect different results. The reality is we know what will happen if we persist in delivering construction and repair materials or if we fortify the Sierra Madre. No? So why keep on doing it, no? When at the end, the national interest might suffer because it will affect our presence in a Yungin-Shon. Now, let me go back to a point that I heard Antonio Carpio said. No? Now, he was, of course, critical in saying that it's as if we gave up our claim to a Yungin.
Yes.
Did we? Of course not. Okay.
If we don't repair and upgrade BRP Sierra Madre, eventually that will disintegrate. And that's the symbolic, right? That's quite symbolic. That's a flashpoint in the area, but it's quite symbolic for Philippine sovereignty of a Yungin-Shon. So if we don't upgrade, that will disintegrate because of the typhoons and the waves. And critics have said that's what China's waiting for.
Well, that's why I'm saying meron tamang diskarte dyan, because I don't believe that Duterte did not repair a Yungin. In fact, I was saying that there were substantial repairs done, no? Even during Duterte's time, but it was not in a manner that was...
You didn't have information, attorney?
No, I mean, I don't have information.
You didn't have that, okay.
Because it's really a derelict ship. And common sense, if you do not make repairs there, then it would have disintegrated completely. Now, let me make an issue with Antonio Carpio. It was he who said in Kapihan, sa Maynila, at least insinuated, that the presence of Sierra Madre militarized Ayungin. And because it is militarized, according to the arbitral tribunal in paragraph 1162, the tribunal did not rule on our prayer to declare China's actions as, in fact, violative of UNCLOS, because the concept of EEZ is that it must not be militarized. Mm-hmm. And it was Antonio Carpio that suggested to
revoke.
make it civilian rule, the presence there, no? And insinuated that perhaps the vessel should be removed. I disagree. What we should do is we should decommission Sierra Madre as a military vessel, make it into a Coast Guard vessel so that it will not be a militarized vessel. And therefore, if we decommission it, then perhaps China will allow it to be repaired. Now, I do not know if China will or will not, but certainly that will make us conform with UNCLOS if we decommission it and make it into a Coast Guard vessel.
So are you saying that right now, since it's a military vessel, I mean, with military officers on board, are we violating UNCLOS at this point?
I did not say that. It's the tribunal. Paragraph 1162 of the arbitral tribunal said that although it forms part of our EEZ, they could not afford us relief on our prayer to declare China's actions in interfering with the delivery of supplies there because militarized EEZ is outside the scope of the UNCLOS. Paragraph 1162.
And we are, is it right to say that right now we can consider Ayungin Shoal, the BRP Sierra Madre, militarized?
Well, that's according to the tribunal. That's not me. That was a decision of the arbitral tribunal, no? And of course, we gained a lot from that arbitral award because now we know that there's no basis for China's historic claims to water, no? And what I'm saying is we have to read that decision and we have to walk the talk. In the same way that we are celebrating our victories or our gains from that decision, we should also learn from what the tribunal said specifically about Sierra Madre and Ayungin.
Okay, so if the Philippines decommissions, right, if the government decommissions BRP Sierra Madre and makes it a Coast Guard vessel and puts civilians there to watch over it, doesn't that weaken our position in Ayungin Shoal?
No, because Coast Guard is considered a civil vessel and it could also be armed for all intents and purposes. No? Mm-hmm. But that's why in international law, you need to avoid sending gray ships. That was our mistake in Scarborough Shoal because we sent our one and only Navy ship, Del Pilar, then, no, to Scarborough to apprehend a Chinese fisherman. No? But take note that even immediately after that incident, China did not send its naval boats. It sent its Coast Guard boats.
But 30 of them. Yeah. But. So let's move on from that particular topic. That's a different one. So I think you've made certain points clear. What you're actually trying to say is there has to be a more effective way. But then you did say in many of your sentences, will China allow? China allow. So that's what doesn't sit well with many of the critics is the Philippines' behavior is dependent on China's approval. Isn't it time that the Philippines change the narrative? And some have said, this is what the administration is doing, President Marcos Jr. It is not moving into, will China allow? President Marcos Jr. is making his own decisions with the belief and intent that that's our sovereign area. So what about that sentence? Your thoughts on, will China allow?
First and foremost, it's not our sovereign area because we don't have sovereignty in the exclusive economic zone, only sovereign rights. Mm. Now, will China allow? Well, we do not know if they will allow or not, but certainly we should sit down with them and ask them, can we repair the Sierra Madre? If we decommission it, will you have any objections further? No? And we need to at least bring it up to them. Because so far, we have not been...
Now, some may see that as a weak negotiating point of view. Would you agree?
No, because if we persist in what we're doing, China will just bar us from Ayungin altogether. And, you know, mark my word, I said it in your program. Mm. If we continue with this course of action, we will be forced to retrieve our soldiers because they will starve to death. Is that what we want? And that is why diplomacy really is not subject to a popularity vote. And that's why it's an exception to freedom of information. No? Leaders must make the right interest pursuant to our national interest, whether or not it is a popular decision.
Hmm. So what do you make of this administration's foreign policy and diplomatic ties with China? I mean, we know that during the Aquino administration, some have said it pivoted extremely to the West. But then During the Duterte administration, it pivoted to China. And then this administration, it pivoted back to the US.
Well, I'm really confused because you see, the president as a candidate only spoke twice about foreign relations, specifically with China. And I remember in the SMNI debate, because he did not appear in any other forum, no, he said that he will continue the policy of independent foreign policy where everyone is a friend and no one is an enemy. No? And he reiterated this when he appeared before the Philippine-Chinese Friendship Society, and I was present before he took his oath as president and said that China is our most important partner. No? But of course, everything changed after his trip to the United States. I don't know what is responsible for this change, but we now find a situation where we have clearly treated China not even as a friend, but perhaps as an enemy, which to me will not bode well for the country. She is our neighbor. She's the second largest economy in the world. She's the second most powerful military in the world. And I think the better option is the option opted by President Duterte. Let's proceed with matters that we could proceed on, matters like trade and investments, and set aside these disputes for the time being. Sabi nga ni Presidente Duterte, let's talk and talk and talk until we die.
Okay, now, the Chinese government has responded to President Marcos Jr. forming the Maritime Council. What are your thoughts on the formation of this Maritime Council? The goal is to strengthen the country's maritime security and domain awareness via information, of course, right? Education, comprehensively tackling serious issues that impacts the country's national security, sovereignty, sovereign rights, maritime jurisdiction, and China has already responded to this. What are your thoughts on the council being formed?
Well, I'm a bit worried because that means 2 years into office, he still does not have a clear policy on China. Why is it only now that he's forming this office? So if he had a very clear idea of how he should proceed with Philippine-China bilateral relations, no? Perhaps what we need is not this council, but better consultations with China experts, including our very own ambassador to Beijing, former CNN bureau chief who's lived there for 30 years and has the equivalent probably of 10 PhDs on China studies. No? So to me, the better option is just to listen to our ambassador because he knows how the Chinese thinks, he knows who to talk to, and he knows better than anyone else how to resolve our disputes with China.
Okay, so moving back now to Yungin Shoal as we close. In the last budget, frankly, I think there was money also set aside to upgrade Kalayaan. That was one, right? But then Yungin clearly was not declared. But then obviously it would be in different parts of the budget, that's for sure, right? It would be more discreet, so to speak. Attorney Roque, do you agree at this point that we should rehabilitate and upgrade BRP Sierra Madre? Do you believe we should do it as a country?
We should do everything necessary to ensure that we retain our soldiers on board Sierra Madre, but in a way that would not provoke the response that we already know is forthcoming from China.
So what can be done? I mean, this government has a policy now of transparency. You've seen the difference, right? In fact, now they take the media on board vessels to actually see what's going on in the West Philippine Sea. They've taken the New York Times, foreign media. We're seeing video playing in social media. It's taken a different turn. This administration is about transparency with what's happening in the West Philippine Sea. It wasn't like that during Duterte's time. So how can we do it kung iba ang diskarte?
Well, yun nga ang sinasabi ko eh, no? Parang kakaibang approach ni Presidente kasi ang foreign policy talaga, exception to freedom of information. And there's a reason for it. Ang nangyayari kasi, nagkakaroon tayo ng parang microphone diplomacy that we want the whole world, no, to hate China because they will be able to see what is happening to our soldiers, no, including those making deliveries. I appreciate that from a PR point of view. But from a diplomatic point of view, what possible gains can we achieve through that? The whole world will be on our side? Fine. But will any one of them actually stand up to China when there's an actual armed conflict, a shooting war? I don't think so, no? Now, of course, we always belabor the point that about 20 or so states have already expressed support for us, no? But at the same time, you're talking of 190 countries worldwide. No? And of course, we know that because of the Belt and Road Initiative, China does have influence over a great many number of nations. So I don't think that's the way to go. An international popularity contest is not the way to go. I think we have to be clear what our national interest is, and we have to be clear on the correct path to achieve those national interests, even if it is not a popular one.
On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, Attorney Harry Roque. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.